In this episode of Finno-Ugric Machining, we are going to turn three pins, which are about 14 centimeters long and 10 millimeters thick in diameter. Well, there will be a fine thread of M10 in each end. Well, so far everything is like usual, but in this case, the diameter must be really consistent and accurate. This is because it's going to be used in an application that doesn't tolerate any play in that one. So therefore, we need to precision turn this this 10 millimeter diameter, and for 14 centimeter long trek, that's not an easy task to do. So, let's go on with this one. This is the material I'm going to make the pins of. This is 16 millimeter in diameter, stainless steel, and they are at the moment 200 millimeters long. And they have been cut with some process, I don't know, maybe, it doesn't look really nice from that end. So, of course, as always, the first operation is to face it. And, easy enough, we have at the moment 800 revolutions per minute. And, the speed, I mean. Put it there. What I do usually, I just stumble the blade on the workpiece and then I lock my carriage here. What this does, why I do it this way, the reason is that I can then use the compound to feed in. So let's see now. That's I think I already faced this head because it looks like it's straight. Okay. Let's do this proper. So I feed in a little bit here. I believe that's okay. So I use the power feed so that it feeds in steadily. So this should create a very nice surface at the end of this workpiece. And this is already trying to sink to us. I can hear. So. And since this is stainless, it might be problematic at some point. Let's see how the surface finish. It feels all right. Then we need a center at this end. As always, when you are trying to turn a precision surface for a long piece, you need to support it at least from both ends. And if it is really long, then you have to support it in the middle as well. You have to have some sort of following rest or something with you. So now, and then I turn this back. Okay. I will make a center here. This is really stainless, so I have to be really careful with this one. It can really grab me. Let's see. I think I need cutting oil and a little bit less speed. Is this all right? Yeah. You it's 400, half the speed. Let's see now. How this goes. Yeah. I can feel already how it is. Quite hefty sender in this case because we need to support it, and later on when I get rid of the taper it's really evident why that is. And then we take this sender, but now I'm just wondering whether this workpiece is, if I take it out, it should be out about that much at least. Let's see if it wobbles. Not much. Okay. I can put it there. In this case you shouldn't put it all the way in, because that will, when we are trying to get rid of the taper, it's not a very good situation. So now I put this here, lock this tailstock here, and then I push just gently. Yeah. It's walking. So now I tighten this. Now, we need at least 14 centimeters here. So, the first thing is of course that we need to find out what is the angle for this, because we cannot go inside there all the way. Well, the previous one is all right, I believe. Yeah, we use that one. And now, since this is tilted, there will be a taper at this end. And now we need, let's see, now I zero my travel indicator here. I'm just setting up the stops, etc., so that 14 is needed, so we go 15. That's 10, that's 15. Do we still have room to rotate here? Yes, plenty. Let's take a little bit more. It doesn't hurt to have some extra here. Yeah, okay. And now I tighten this carriage stop into this place. And now the feeds and feeds for... We are first roughing this. And therefore, I'm going to use the 800 because of the diameter. Let's see. This is going to be so fun. Okay. I will feed this with the maximum feed, which is 0.152 millimeters per revolution. And the speed was 800 and reveal of 1 millimeter. And the feed direction, and this one as well. Let's see. Wait a minute. Yeah, it's in contact. Let's see about this. Okay. I think we can try this one. Let's first test the stop. I want to test it so that it really stops there. Yes, it does. It has happened to me that it didn't stop, but this was sliding away, and that's not very good thing to happen. So that was the zero, and then we take 1 millimeter from diameter, and we should be good to go. Let's see. Wow, that's funny. This one got loose quite a lot, actually. Why?
Well, the reason is thermal expansion. When I turned this, it became quite hot and longer, and it pushed the tailstock back. During the second pass, it had cooled down sufficiently to disconnect the center from the end of the workpiece. It started vibrating, and the violent vibrations did the rest of the job.
Yeah. These. Now it's the time and place to get rid of her. Well, wow. Maybe, well, it started to sing to us for some reason. Maybe I should check the tightness of this as well. Well, it was tight. Tight. And tight, yeah. Okay. So let's see. Yeah. There you are. No, we are not there. Let's go on with this one. Ah. Now, well, the surface is, well, I kind of feel it because it's so hot. So we have here 10.55 And here we have 10.70. So we still have the same taper all the way. But now, next step, I will change the tool. Okay, now it's cooled down. And I also noticed that when it had cooled down, it had already loosened this. So the thermal expansion is really something that you shouldn't neglect here. So now, this is the tool I'm going to use to get it to the final dimension. And now I'm going to take very... I'm going to take very fine cuts here. So the first I will take is 0.1. Let's do that. Only 0.1 millimeter. And the feet is now this 0.078 something. And let's see now. About tooling, you should actually tighten the tool. That's it's man. Well, there you can see how negligible the forces are with this tool. These are really like nothing. Okay, I have to go back and start it over. Now I will pull it away from that. Well, the surface finish is definitely really, really good. This is 10.16. And this is 10.... Oh yeah. We already did. How did that come? This is now... Well, at this end it's suitable. This was not a very good demonstration of this thing. We have to redo. This is actually scrap. I scrapped it. I decided to change to the finishing tool not when we have half a millimeter, but when we have 1 millimeter left. Because, the roughing tool started to chatter here, and I don't want that. I don't see any chatter marks yet, but it was definitely starting to. And now I'm taking 0.1 millimeter cuts. Two times here first, just to make it so that if there is some thickness variations here, it will minimize those. And I'm also using cutting oil.
whistles. Wow.
Okay. Well, the surface finishes at this time, it's really nice. So what we have here is 10.79 here, maybe 77, 79-ish. It's tapered heavily at that end. And here we have 11.2. Here we have 10.95. So it's linear. Good. Now, next step will be to straighten this out. I will now set up camera so that you can see what I'm doing here. Okay, now we have everything ready here for this demonstration on how to take the taper out of turning a piece like this, a long slender piece. Well, the first thing is that everything must be clean, especially the ways. You have to, this piece should be cool, not warm, and then you should make sure that your tailstock is connected to the workpiece. Well, the easiest way is of course to try to turn this piece, and if it doesn't turn, then it's connected. Well, it's connected. Normally you would see that, okay, it's let's assume that it's 0.2 millimeters larger at this end and smaller at this end. So there is a 0.2 millimeter taper. Actually, in this case, it's even more. But yeah. So what you would normally do, you would, if it is thinner at this end and larger at this end, you would move the tailstock like 0.1 millimeter, which is half the taper, to that direction. Okay. Well, that doesn't give you an accurate result, because you don't know where this this thing is pivoting. Is it pivoting from here? Is it pivoting somewhere in the bearings of the headstock bearings? Maybe they are pivoting. Is it pivoting there in between? You don't know. Therefore, you always get some taper after moving that. No matter how accurately you move it, you cannot get it totally eliminated. Well, this method I'm presenting here is a little bit different. So let's start discussing about this taper. We have this end which is smaller and this end which is larger. And there is a certain amount difference between those two. And now our goal is to get them the same. So this end should be moved away from the tool in relation with that end, half of the taper. Not absolutely in relation. And whenever you move this end that direction, also this end moves somewhat to that direction as well. So therefore we need to measure the difference. And yeah, so as you can see, I'm measuring from the backside of this workpiece. If I would measure it on the front side, that would not give me actually nothing, because it traces the tool setup and I see no change in my dial indicator. But if you do it from the back side, you actually are measuring the deviation in diameter. Okay. You measure it from the backside, and you should make sure that your dial indicator is on the center line height. And then you should also make sure that you have known points where to measure. This is one known point, there is a carriage stop. And another known point is this start. When my handle is actually, when the handle is straight down. Well, it doesn't matter how you define those two points, but you have to do that. So the first task is to, I now move the carriage so that the dial indicator shows something, and I zero it at this end. Like that. I need my optimizer. This needs to be done quite accurately. Okay? Yeah, there it is. And now I go that way to the carriage stop. And then I read the dial indicator, which is showing me something. It's showing 27.5. So 27.5. Take a note of that. It's important. You need to know that later on. So I recheck this. Yeah. Now it's more like 28. Maybe it's 28. Ah, no. Ah, I succeeded in moving this. Now. Yeah, it's 27.5. Now you divide this by 2. Okay, now that I have learned how to use my new calculator, man, this is really somewhat horrific. Okay, so 27.5 divided by 2 equals, and now it's telling me it's 55 divided by 4. Okay, but what we will do, we press this button and we get 13.75. Okay, 13.75. That's actually, and yeah, 13.75. So, 13.75. And this is actually now hundredths of a millimeter, these figures here. So, what we are now going to do is that when I start here and move it here, the deviation should be 13.75. Then we have a zero to taper. Okay, so we need to, first of all, there is a thing here back in the tailstock which locks the tailstock in place in a way. I loosen that. And then we have here an adjustment screw, but let's take it here first. So, in order to eliminate that, the needle should be moving to the same direction what it was moving. Let's see if I can do that. That's wrong direction. Oh, no, now it's wrong direction. So, 13. I think we need to move quite a lot at first. Oh. Let's take that first. Note that I didn't loosen the tailstock at all. So, yeah, now I zero this dial and see where we are, how much does it move. So we should be 13.75. It's 14. I guess we were just lucky, because this is very near. This is very near to the final, but I'll check this out one more time. Like that. Yeah, there it is, actually. Wow. one more time, but this time I will see that this here is actually loose, yes, and then I will lock this. Sometimes these settings move when I lock the sideways thing. This time it didn't. And now we recheck that we have it correctly. 13.75. It's actually 14.5, so this would give us almost 200ths of a millimeters. Yeah, but this... Let's see one more time. Oh, well, I will take a whiff out of it, because it now looks like we are, well, this way, actually we are already very near the final, but I'm just wanting to make this perfect, so... Just a little bit. This doesn't want to move on me. I only want to move maybe half a hundredth. There you are. Then tighten this and see. We are here at the end. Yeah, now it's 13.75, as far as I can read it correctly. So, that's done. So now we should have it in a correct place. Well, it will be seen whether this produces us non-tapered result. But we can test this. Just tighten the tool. Yeah, and this, I recheck that we are at the correct place here, because I don't want to, I didn't move any of these settings. It's okay. And then since this was almost, there was quite a lot of difference, I will peel, before measuring, I will peel it twice. So, let's see now, this was tight, yeah. We should have 0.2 millimeters left to go, meaning that the diameter at the moment should be 10.2. Quite exactly, but you never know, it might, well, 10.18, 10.19 and some change. 10.18, so now this and that end are exactly the same. So it becomes better and better on every pass, really. That's Well, now we take only 0.1 millimeter, and after that we take the rest. These are now the two last passes here. First I peel off 0.1 millimeter. Well, and I have what I have done, I have slowed down the feed to 0.038 millimeters per revolution. And I also, well, the speed is the same, so here we go. Put some cutting oil here, and there we go. It's a really slow feed, but I'm after a good surface finish here, so. Okay, I'll move you up to the shelf, so you can see what I'm doing. Oh, there you go. Yeah. And let's zoom out a little bit like that. Zoom in. Then set the focus. Well, when I'm setting focus, I'm setting this here, so it knows where to focus. This darn thing cannot focus on my leg. It needs some. There you are. Okay, I think we are there. Okay, let's take now this focus equipment away. Well, now let's wipe this with my focus equipment. And this is not too warm, actually. It's quite, it's lukewarm, like hand. This should be 10.1 now, and it's 10.7 here. I mean 10.07. 10.09. Okay, so how much do I want to take away? 10.7, 10.9, 10. I would like to take away something like 0.1 millimeters. Then it's undersized here, undersized here, and a little bit undersized in the middle. Should be. Oh well. Yeah. I leave it a width open so that like that. Well, you could put the dial indicator here to move it accurately, but this dial here is also quite accurate. So I have learned to pass the rest. So now this is the final pass. Contact is okay. And there you go, last pass.
Yeah. Now we will see. Wow. This. The surface finish is leaving not much to wish for. Well, okay. So this is 9.99. This is, well, 10 exactly. And this is, well, 10 exactly. Well, it's 1/100 of a millimeter small here and otherwise straight. Good. Now we will test it. Well, I don't want to move the tailstock, so this might be a little bit cumbersome. Hopefully I can fit my piece in there. Well, this is a reamed 10H7. It should slide all the way through. And it does. Good. Well, before parting it out from there. Now, I really don't want to move this tailstock now, because when I do the next piece, it's very good when it's in place already. Wow. That's okay now. Well, it still has this whistle when you wipe it, but yeah, okay. Now we part it. And well, we had a trouble with our parting tool. Last time I used it, I noticed that it's too high. too low, I mean. So we need to adjust it. So lucky me, I have made this adjustment tool, which can be used, so it should be, and yeah, it's way too, okay, now it's there, I think, yeah, it's there, just a whiff under that point. Usually the parting tool is good to be a little bit under, so it cuts easier. Okay. And now, there. And then I... So, the length should be 14 millimeters. So I go here, hopefully I can go here. Oh yeah, I can go here. And then there. It has to be tightened. Man, I always forget it. So I push it against the workpiece, zero my dial, this travel indicator here. So we need the plate width is 3 millimeters. So 143 millimeters. Should be around here. 43 is there. Yeah. Wow, is it really? We left quite a lot. So this is 0. And then that's 100.
20, 30, 40, and 3. Well, I can give it one more millimeter. Like that. Well, there you are, it is there. So, lock the carriage here. And then I put back this. Don't tighten it like crazy. I think it should be there. And then, well, let's take one step slower. That should be okay. Then we need cutting point. And I first beat this manually and see how it behaves. Well, it doesn't want to bite. Okay, I grind the tool. I did the grinding for this blade and now it's cutting as it should. It's a little bit crunchy. This usually are, but it doesn't require excess force. That's one thing I hate when it this still requires quite a lot of force. We are here approaching the it probably won't stop. There is just a little nibble. I'll cut it by bending. I don't want to destroy my tool here like this. Well, this is... Well, there you are. 1 10 millimeter shaft. Two more to go. So, that was the story about three precision pins. Making those pins out of stainless steel was not difficult, but it required some attention, so to say. Other than that, maybe some taper eliminating methods. I hope you learned something new here. What are those pins for? Well, they are for this... This is the sailboat mast platform, and the three pins are here. And the reason why they have to be so precise is the holes. They are reamed to 10H7, and they cannot be. There shouldn't be any plane on them, not much anyway. And at the moment, this is really nice. Well, in the next episode of Finno-Greek Machining, there is always this rotating welding positioner. I think I promised to make the food for that one. Maybe that. Till then, bye!